style during Christmas time. We're in the season of Advent. So let's prepare our hearts as we sing and worship our Lord. Stand together.
Of glory, wing your flight o'er all the earth. You who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Shepherds in the fields abide. adore him, Christ the Lord. Who are we that you would be mindful of us? What do you see that's worth a look in our way? We are free in ways that we never should.
Some of the folks standing around you.
Thank you. Good morning, friends. Welcome to Duck Church. I'm glad that we have the opportunity to be here together today as we worship our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I've got a few things to lift up before we get to the connection card this morning. In your bulletin, there is a little sheet. You know, I grew up all my life calling these poinsettias. Somebody corrected me some years ago, said it's poinsettia. So if you would like to donate a plant, either in honor or in memory of someone, the deadline's next Sunday, so we got to move on that pretty quick. But we want to have the sanctuary all decorated up as we approach the Christmas season and the festivities that are associated with that. So please get those filled out and get those turned back in. Also, there are still some Christmas ornaments from this year's installation, which is a picture of the altar area with the cross and the window. And if you would like one of those, I think they're available in the fellowship hall, as well as limited supplies of previous years, because we've been doing this for a few years now. And they're $5 each. They make a great gift for someone. We always get some for our kids and for my mom, and pass those along. So, next thing, I'm going to apologize once for all the coughing I'm going to do today. I am not contagious. It is my seasonal asthma is here. And it's the great thing about it for a pastor is it's only exacerbated when I talk. So, anyway, so there's that. I also want to share with you this morning that I am honored and deeply humbled that I have been asked to serve as the presiding elder for our new district in the Global Methodist Church. I'll still be the pastor here. It's a different model than what the district superintendent currently is, but I'm really excited about the opportunity to serve the church in a wider capacity by providing leadership for our district, but I would love your prayers. So please pray for your pastor as we enter into this new year. All right, connection card. You'll find one in your bulletin looking just like this one, and if you would take a moment to sign in, that would be great. Share as much information as you want to share with us. That would be wonderful. On the back side, there are some next steps. Last week, I asked you to begin praying for people that you would like to invite to the Christmas Eve services this week. I'd like to encourage you to share those names so that the prayer team can also join you in praying for those folks. Don't forget, those of you who have gifts for the children in Allander, those are due next Sunday. And you can bring them and put them in the fellowship hall. I think there's a table nearby the tree that's still up there in the fellowship hall. We want to make sure we get all of those in on time so that they can be delivered before Christmas. Our scripture today is Luke chapter 1, verse 38. And the message is the journey before the journey. In my reading this past week, I came across something that Watchman Nee said about submission. He said this: revelation is the first step to holiness, and consecration is the second. A day must come in our lives as definite as the day of our conversion when we give up all right to ourselves and submit to the absolute lordship of Jesus Christ. Everyone is welcome here in the Duck Church family, where we learn the importance of submitting our will to God's will. And as we begin our time together this morning, John and Marion Schmidt are going to come to light our second candle on the Advent wreath. So as they are making their way forward, let me share this with you. The Sundays of Advent are a time of preparation for the coming of Christ and the celebration of his birth. On the second Sunday in Advent, we light the candle of love, for the coming of Christ into our lives brings love.
Second Sunday of Advent. We light this candle as a symbol of love. May the love of God, which is made flesh in Jesus Christ, lead us to the way of salvation.
Thank you. We come now to our time for prayer this morning. And as we do, I've got some requests that I'd like to share with you. Excuse me. I said I was only going to say that once, but I'm probably going to say it multiple times. We continue to pray for Amy. And if you notice, this week she was able to stand instead of having to sit. So there's progress all the way through here as she recovers from her recent surgery for cancer. Also, we lift up prayers for Lois Green, who is in the hospital. And at the same time she was in the emergency room, John Park was in the emergency room. He has since been moved to a hospital in Virginia. He's doing well, but we pray for his healing as well. We want to pray for the people of Ukraine, people in our country that serve in the military and their families. Also prayers for Gwen, who is a teenager who is going through cancer. And are there others that we should lift in prayer together this morning? Anyone else? Yes. Clark family. Anyone else? All right. Well, let's go before the Lord as we pray. Father, as we gather together on this second Sunday of Advent where we highlight your love, we are grateful that your love is not just the feeling that you have about us. It's more than that. It's not just a sentiment that you say. It's more than that. But it's an action that you take in many and varied ways. And we are thankful for the many expressions of your love that have come to us through other people through the years. People who have invested in us, people who have loved and accepted and encouraged us and guided us in the way that leads to you. And today, out of that same love that we've learned from you, we come before you to thank you for who you are, for all you've done, to thank you for the privilege of prayer at any time, in any place. And out of that same love, we're motivated to pray on behalf of others, those that we love and care for, and those circumstances on the world stage. We think about the people in Hawaii, where there are two active volcanoes going on right now. We think about the people in Ukraine who are suffering. We think about our military families who someone is always on deployment, and we pray for them and for their families. We pray for those closer to home, those that we name on our lips and those that we name in our hearts. Many that we pray for, and this is true every week, are in need of a healing from you. There are those in hospitals and nursing homes and rehab facilities, and those at home who are recovering, and they need the strength that comes from your Spirit. They need the healing that only you can grant. And we pray for one another today, that as we have gathered in this place, we could learn the value of the journey before the journey and begin that first journey today. Bless our time together in this space. We worship you, we adore you, we love you, and we're so grateful that you're in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, friends, as we... I know that's distracting. It's distracting to me. But as we turn to God's word this morning, found in Luke chapter 1, verse 38, I want to say that I believe with all my heart that this is the inspired word of God. It is God's love letter, as we emphasize love today. It is God's love letter to all humanity. And as we read God's word together this morning, let's be attuned to how we can apply it to our lives so that we can receive all the goodness that God has in store for us today. So this passage this morning, just a verse that comes on the heels of the angel Gabriel coming to share with Mary God's plan for her life. And in verse 38, we read this. Mary responded, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." And then the angel left her. Would you pray with me? Almighty God, you are the source of all light. You divinely separated light from darkness so that we may have the beauty of the light of day. Father, illuminate this day and enlighten us as we seek to know you through your word. May we be led by your light so our hearts may be open to your word. We pray that we would receive every word you speak to us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, in the scenes from last week's message, you'll remember that the little town of Bethlehem had been chosen long ago as the birthplace of the Messiah. And a cadre of magi from the east had began their 1,000-mile journey to the region of Judea in search for a star. And Augustus Caesar, the emperor of Rome, had put together a plan to tax the world, which would require every citizen to return to their ancestral home and submit to an official registration. And 80 miles north of Jerusalem in the region of Galilee, in a small town named Nazareth, a young woman named Mary was betrothed to a man named Joseph. Now, betrothal, if you were here last week, you might remember, is the stage between courtship and marriage in which a couple has made a legally binding commitment to one another, but they don't yet live in the same house or sleep in the same bed. Mary and Joseph were betrothed. Their wedding was still months away. And then one afternoon, as Mary was spending some time alone saying her prayers, suddenly the angel Gabriel appeared to her. And you know, someday we're going to know Gabriel, and we're going to hear him tell the story from his perspective. And he said this to Mary, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." The Bible says that she was troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this could be. And look, there may be angels all around us. I believe there are, but it's not every day that we see them. And it's certainly not every day that we have a conversation with them. Gabriel spoke to Mary in a strong and yet gentle voice, saying, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God." Now, he may have said this because Mary was frightened by his presence, or he may have said it because these words would be words that Mary would need to cling to in the coming months and even for the rest of her life. "Mary, do not be afraid." What the angel was about to tell her and what she was about to experience no doubt seemed like more than she could possibly bear, but God would be with her every step of the way. And this is what Gabriel said, "You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." Now, the part about the throne of David and the house of Jacob didn't have time to sink in because Mary couldn't quite get past the first item on the list. "You will conceive and give birth to a son." And she understood that Gabriel was not talking about in the years to come after she and Joseph were married. Gabriel was talking about now, today, in this moment. And so she asked, "How can this happen since I am a virgin?" The angel Gabriel said, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, and this baby will be holy. He will be called the Son of God." And maybe it was at that moment that Mary recalled the ancient prophecy from the scrolls of Isaiah. "Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and you shall call his name Emmanuel." And if you've been around church circles for a while, you know that Emmanuel means God with us. And while Gabriel's words were still hanging in the air, he gave Mary more news. Your elderly kinswoman, Elizabeth, who has long been thought to be barren, unable to conceive, will also have a child. In fact, she's in her sixth month. And then Gabriel spoke the words to Mary that we ourselves have seen again and again are certainly true. For nothing is impossible with God. How could Mary respond? She said, "I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said." It took but a short time for Mary to make the journey from "How can this be?" to "May it be to me as you have said." This journey was made possible by the power of a simple phrase, "I am the Lord's servant." Now, what about this elderly relative named Elizabeth that Gabriel mentioned? Who is she? Well, she is the distant cousin or distant aunt who lived in the hill country near Jerusalem. Her husband, Zechariah, was from the tribe of Aaron, which meant that he was a priest. In those days, there were thousands of descendants of Aaron all over Judea who served as priests at the temple for 1 week every 6 months. For them, these weeks of service were often the highlight of their whole year. This particular year was especially meaningful for Zechariah because the lot fell to him to be the one to enter into the sanctuary of the temple before the morning service and burn incense as a prayer offering to God. Since there were so many priests in each priestly order, it was a rare opportunity to be chosen, a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Now, Zechariah and Elizabeth were both good and godly people, righteous in God's eyes, the Bible says. They were careful to obey all the Lord's commands. There was only one hindrance to their joy. They were childless. In their culture, couples didn't remain childless by choice, and they were the objects of pity or suspicion. It was considered by many to be a form of chastisement from God. Now, Zechariah and Elizabeth had prayed for years that God would bless them with a family, and it appeared that their prayers would be left unanswered. They were now old enough at this point to have come to terms with the idea that this was never going to happen for them. There would be no sons. There would be no daughters to continue their legacy. And on this particular morning, Zechariah entered the temple sanctuary, and as he did, worshipers were gathered outside praying, and it was a custom that after the lighting of incense, the priest would step outside and offer a blessing to the people. But this day, it seemed to be taking longer than it should. That's because when Zechariah stepped up to the altar to light the incense, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared, and it just happened to be Gabriel, the same angel who would speak to Mary in just a few months. The angel said, "Don't be afraid, Zechariah. God has heard your prayer. Your wife, Elizabeth, will give you a son, and you will name him John. He will be great in the eyes of the Lord. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and he will cause those who are rebellious to accept the wisdom of the godly." Zechariah's first thought was that both he and Elizabeth were way too old to conceive a child. And then he asked a question that seems to be similar to the one Mary asked, but Zechariah's question came from a different place. When the angel told Mary that she would be with child, she asked, "How can this be since I'm a virgin?" She didn't doubt the angel. She just didn't understand how it could happen. Zechariah, on the other hand, was skeptical. He asked, "How can I be sure of this?" As in, "How do I know you're telling me the truth? What proof can you offer?" Gabriel's response was, in effect, "Since you don't believe my words, I'll give you proof. You will be silent and unable to speak until the day your son is born." So when Gabriel left the sanctuary, Zechariah left the sanctuary, he was unable to speak. Everyone had understood that he had seen a vision, but they didn't know exactly what had happened. And soon, Elizabeth did become pregnant, even at her advanced age. As the angel told Mary, for nothing is impossible with God. Elizabeth's response, "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people." Now, Mary knew about Elizabeth's condition because of the angel. But Elizabeth knew nothing of Mary's situation. In fact, no one did. Not even Joseph knew about it at this point. When Mary arrived at the home of Elizabeth and Zechariah, she called out to announce her arrival. Elizabeth heard her and came running, saying, "Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb," which is a King James way of saying, "You're pregnant, and I'm happy for you because God is choosing to do something special." Mary was at the earliest stages of her pregnancy, so Elizabeth had no way of knowing this except that God revealed it to her. And the Bible says that at that moment, she was filled with the Holy Spirit, and then she said, "Why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy." In other words, this child that you're carrying is not merely a child. He is the Lord. He is the Messiah. Now, I'm going to put the narrative on hold just a minute, and would you allow me to preach for just a few minutes? I'll get back to it, but I want you to hear this loud and clear. Everyone needs an Elizabeth. Mary, no doubt, was surrounded by cynics and critics and those who would question her story because, as everyone knows, virgins don't give birth to babies. But Elizabeth had experienced her own miracle in recent months, so she knew something of the God who makes possible that which is impossible. And now, here she was speaking words of encouragement and affirmation to a young girl who was facing an overwhelming future. Everyone needs an Elizabeth, which is why Mary sought her out. And there will be times in your life where you need an Elizabeth, a Holy Spirit-filled friend who has seen God at work in their lives and who has the wisdom to recognize God at work in yours. Everyone needs an Elizabeth, and everyone needs to look for the opportunity to be an Elizabeth. Naysayers need not apply, because they know nothing about the power of God. But if you have experienced God's hand in your life, if you have been filled with the Holy Spirit, then you need to look for opportunities to speak words of encouragement and affirmation to others. If Mary had any doubts or uncertainties, the words of Elizabeth put them to rest. And from that point on, if she wasn't already, Mary was all in. She said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed." Mary was saying, God is no elitist. He loves even the poor and simple people like me. Holy is his name. Mary knew that the road ahead could be difficult. There were still a lot of unanswered questions. What would Joseph do? What would her parents say? What would everyone else think? She didn't know the answers to those questions at this point, but it no longer mattered. She knew in the deepest part of her soul that the love of God would see her through. So Mary stayed with Elizabeth for 3 months, and when she returned, there was no hiding the truth. If Joseph didn't know before, he certainly knew now, as Mary's body had begun to change. Now, this would have been a scandal in their little community. The assumption would have been that Joseph and Mary had broken custom and were intimate before the appointed time. If that were so, shame on Joseph. Or it would mean that Mary had betrayed Joseph with another man. If that were true, shame on Mary. Of course, no one would have been thinking, perhaps this child was conceived by the Holy Spirit. And can you imagine how Joseph must have felt? The hurt, the sense of betrayal, the anger, the indignation, and the fear that comes from realizing that you don't even know this person. And maybe it wasn't the first time. And maybe it won't be the last. The fear of not knowing. And then the hurt starts all over again. Joseph's world had fallen apart. His plans and hopes for the future had turned to dust. Now, Joseph had the right to make a public accusation, which would force Mary to face the consequences, which very possibly could have meant her death. But he couldn't bring himself to do that. Because you don't stop loving someone just because they hurt you and you know the relationship has to end. Joseph decided that the best course of action was to quietly divorce Mary without subjecting her to more ridicule than she was certain to face already. And then he would try to pick up the pieces and move on with his life, and Mary would probably move away to live the rest of her life with family members in another region. And then, one night in a dream, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph and said, "Do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." Now, Joseph knew what this would mean if he were to go through with the marriage. He knew what those around him would assume. They would never look at him again in the same light. But that didn't matter to Joseph. He was, in the words of Matthew, a righteous man. He was a man of faith and courage, and he was good for the task. Mary need not live her life in shame or run off to another region. She would stay with him here in Nazareth, and if anyone wanted to say tisk tisk, they could say the worst about him, but never about Mary. And so it was settled. Joseph and Mary would move forward together. They would pick up where their hopes and dreams for the future left off. With one minor modification, they would be raising the very Son of God. Now, in this story, you'll notice how each character took their own spiritual journey to a place of surrender to God's will. Before they could begin the journey to fulfill God's call on their lives, they needed to take the journey first to a place of surrender. The journey before the journey, if you will. With Joseph, there was never any doubt of him doing the right thing. He just needed a word from God, wisdom from God, direction from God. And so God spoke to him. Zechariah needed a little more proof. "How can I be sure?" he asked. The angel said, "I'll silence your doubt by silencing your voice. Is that proof enough?" Mary's journey to surrender was but a few steps. Elizabeth played a role in giving Mary much needed affirmation. But from the very beginning, she was able to say, "I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said." So very quickly, I want to give a quick application of today's story, and I want to leave you with three thoughts. First of all, you are more qualified than you think you are. Maybe your attitude is, "Who am I that God would choose me?" And I'll have to be honest, when I was called and asked to serve our district in this manner, that was exactly what I thought. Who am I that God would choose me? And if that's your thinking, then you're exactly in the place you need to be, because God uses ordinary people, or even those that we might consider less than ordinary. People from the sticks, people from the wrong side of town, people from broken homes and dysfunctional families, people who can't get into the good schools, people who have to work multiple jobs in order to put food on the table, people for whom this world has never given them a break. There is a place for you. 1 Samuel says, "Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." God has his eye on you. He has plans for you. The second thought, God will give you the confirmation and direction you need when you need it. For Mary, it was the affirming words of Elizabeth. For Zechariah, it was a season of silence. For Joseph, it was a dream in the night. God's hand will lovingly lead you to the place of surrender. He'll tell you what you need to know. He will lead you where you need to go. And he will place the right people in your life. And he will give you the wisdom and direction you need when you need it. I'm saying that a life of following Christ isn't just a journey that you have to take alone. God is with you, and he will bring others into your life as well. And then the third thought to consider, the journey before the journey begins today. Even before Mary came into Joseph's life, he had already decided the kind of man he would be. He would be the kind of man who would seek to do right, not to seek revenge. From the very beginning, his heart was where it needed to be. And Mary, even before the angel came to visit, she had already decided what kind of woman she would be. Mary merely said to the angel what she had already said in her heart. There's a journey of great distance that God will call you to take in your life. It involves your work and your family and your church and people you know and the people you serve and people whose lives you will influence in the years to come. In this journey with a capital J that defines your life, we have to realize that we have to make another journey first. Before we take that journey, we must take this journey to a place of surrender. Today, I'm challenging you to take the first step of this journey before the journey to surrender, the journey that concludes with the phrase, I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said. What happens next? Only God knows, but you can be sure that God is up to something. Today we've talked about a journey that concludes with the phrase, I am the Lord's servant. Next week, we're going to follow our characters on a different kind of journey. We'll see once again that God is no elitist. God has a plan and a place for everyone who is willing to say, I am the Lord's servant. Thanks be to God. Amen. Friends, we're going to enter now into a celebration of Holy Communion. And in our church, we practice open communion, which means everyone that's here is welcome to participate in this holy sacrament. Children, youth, adults, everyone is welcome to this place. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to God, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And when the supper was over, Jesus took a cup. He asked God to bless it. And then he gave it to his disciples and he said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. O God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. When we break the bread, is it not a sharing in the body of Christ? And likewise, when we give thanks over the cup, is it not a sharing in the blood of Christ? The body and blood of Christ given for me. Amen. And those that are assisting as they make their way forward, I'll just say that we'll be receiving communion by the method of intinction. And what that means is one of the servers will break a piece of bread off, give that to you. You take the piece of bread, dip it in the cup, and receive both elements in that manner. So the ushers will direct you in just a moment. You'll come down. There'll be stations on either side here. You come receive communion and then return to your seat by your side aisle until everyone has had the opportunity to receive the sacrament. So friends, we're going to continue our worship by receiving the offering this morning. So I'd like everyone, if you will, to consider what your next step is going to be on your connection card. We've got some great opportunities next Sunday. The choir will be offering the Christmas cantata at the 8 o'clock and the 9:30 service, and then 4 o'clock next Sunday afternoon will be the children's Christmas program here in the sanctuary. So we're looking forward to those opportunities. So if you're with us for the first time today, we're so glad that you have joined us. And we've got a little gift for you. It's a little book called How Good Is Good Enough, and it's all about how to know for certain that you'll go to heaven one day. We want you to be sure about that. So Just drop your completed connection card in the offering plate when it's passed in just a moment, and then there's a table on the back wall on the right side that has many copies of the book. Please pick one up, take it home, and read it. It's our way of saying thank you for worshiping with us today. Joining Mary's joyful song, our souls proclaim the greatness of the Lord, and our spirits rejoice in God our Savior. With humble and generous and grateful hearts, let us bring our offerings to God.
Looks like another silent night. Above your deep and dreamless sleep, a giant star lights up the sky. And while you're lying in the dark, there shines an everlasting light. The king has left his throne, and he's sleeping in a manger tonight. Oh, Bethlehem, what you have missed while you were sleeping. For God became a man and stepped into your world today. Oh, Bethlehem, you will go down in history as a city with no room for its king. While you were sleeping, while you were sleeping, Mary shivers in the cold, trying to keep the Savior warm. Looks like another silent night. The Father gave his only Son, the way, the truth, the life had come, but there was no room for him in the world he came to save. Jerusalem, what you have missed while you were sleeping, the Savior of the world is dying on your cross today. Jerusalem, you will go down in history as a city with no room for its king. While you were sleeping, while you were sleeping, United States of America, looks like another silent night. as we're sung to sleep by philosophies that stave the trees and kill the children. And while we're lying in the dark, there's a shout heard across the eastern sky. For the bridegroom has returned, and he's carried his bride away in the night, in the night. America, what will we miss while we are sleeping? Will Jesus come again and leave us slumbering where we lay? A nation with no room for its king. Will we be sleeping? Will we be sleeping? United States of America looks like another silent night.
Psalm 24 says to lift up our heads and let the King of Glory come in. So this morning, as we prepare for Christ's coming on Christmas Day in the season of Advent, let's sing to the Lord and invite him into our lives as we leave this place and bring him into the world. Let's stand together.
Them up, you ancient doors, that the King
You know, God does not always do things in the way we might expect, but God always reveals himself to those who seek him. If you're in town next weekend, be sure to come back next Sunday, as we're going to be focused on Luke chapter 1, verse 49, and the message will be coloring outside the line, something I was very good at as a child. I hope that you'll join us, and I hope that you'll invite a friend to come and worship with you. And now let's receive this blessing. Magnify the Lord and rejoice, for nothing is impossible with God. And the blessing of God, who gave us the best that he had, be with you now and always. Amen.
Lift up your heads, O ye gates.